I'm going to show running the Testlab software, and we'll go through some of the basics of it. So the first thing you might do is hopefully you've got Testlab installed. And if you do, you have this icon on your desktop, or you would have it in your start menu, Testlab 2019.1. When you click on that, you'd think, okay, well, this icon should start Testlab, but it actually opens a bunch of folders. If you're new to Testlab, part of the challenge is figuring out what it is that you do with this menu. And really, it kind of comes down to whether you're going to analyze data or if you're going to acquire data. If you're going to analyze data, you can go to this desktop. The desktop is a piece of software that lets you view data that you've already acquired, and it lets you do analysis. And what's interesting about this, so it's opening up here, you would get this thing that says documentation, navigator, and then you got an empty project called Project One here, and that's what it normally starts up with. If you look in this folder structure, you'll see that a lot of these folders actually say the word analysis in them. So there's Testlab structures analysis. You also see there's general processing. These are all things that you do after data is acquired. And if I look in this folder, Testlab structures analysis, you'll see things like modal analysis here. Well, from the desktop, I can actually go to this tools add-ins and I can pick out of the desktop modal analysis, because maybe that's the task. I want to analyze some data today. I'm going to do a modal analysis. I hit OK, and that will add in modal analysis and the steps that I need to do it, which you follow from left to right, into the desktop. So from the desktop, I can start this application. It's actually pretty much the same as if I double-clicked here and started my analysis directly. Now, it does say desktop here because I started desktop first. Here it says modal analysis. But what you'll see is after I start this, it'll have the desktop tabs, this documentation and navigator. And then it has all the modal analysis tabs. So really, it's the same thing. If I went under tools add-ins here and I turned off modal analysis because I'm going to do a operational deflection shape instead. Well, there's an icon for that, or under tools add-ins, operational. So there it is, operational deflection shapes. And so that starts that just the same. So I guess I mentioned these things because if you're a new user, a little bit intimidating to see that you have all these different folders when in fact they're a bit redundant with what are under these add-ins over here. I'm going to exit out here. Now, if it's an acquisition thing, and here you'd have to know something about the names in our software, something like signature acquisition is used to acquire data. This means it's going to talk to some SCADIS hardware where you've plugged in some transducers, you know, accelerometers, strain gauges, whatever. That you have to start directly. You have to start the acquisition software in the mode that you're going to acquire data. Here under the structures acquisition, for example, are things like impact testing, if you're going to use a modal impact hammer to take some data. Or under environmental are things like vibration control modules, like random control, shock control. There I have to start the acquisition package directly. So that's analysis. I can start from this desktop. Acquisition, I have to start direct. If you don't like clicking through all these folders, you know, you might do something like create a shortcut here, and then I can just start my desktop anytime I want to analyze data. And if I'm really doing a lot of signature testing, which I think I'll demo, I could create a shortcut for that, and then I would have that on my desktop, and then I wouldn't have to click through all these folders every time I wanted to start those things. If I double click on signature, it looks like this. In the corner here, there's actually an icon, new project. If I click on that, it'll start a new project file with the default settings. Normally, it would actually start with project one. I think I had a project already open, so it's calling it project two. And it went out, talked to the hardware that I have present. Now I'm in a new project. If I start something like PowerPoint, when I fire up PowerPoint, what does it start with? Like a blank project. It calls it presentation one. And Testlab is doing the same thing. It starts with a project one. And if I want to keep this presentation around a lot longer, you know, I've made some changes, what should I do here? So you would do file, save as, right? And give it a name. Same thing in Testlab. So after we start up, I would highly recommend that you do a file, save as. And you can give this project, instead of having it be called project one, give it a name like, I don't know, Fred. And then hit save, and now you're in Project Fred here, and all your data and everything you collect is going to be stored in Fred. So I'm in a new project. I called it Fred, and I can acquire data in here. In Fred, if I go to this thing called the Navigator, it lets me see the contents of the project. It's completely empty, but it does by default have this thing called Section 1. And this section concept, it's kind of an interesting concept. This project file, so one I do save as here, it's called Fred with a .lms extension. So the .lms is the project file extension. The section is actually a subdivision within this project. And there's some icons here where you can create a new section. So for example, maybe the first tests I'm going to be doing are in a baseline condition. So I would hit OK here. And now I have a section called baseline. I have a default section that came with the software called section one, and I don't have to use that if I don't want to. I can delete that. And then maybe I could create a new section. I'm gonna do a modification to my product. At some point I'll do modification A. And this helps me organize my data. I don't have to use these sections if I don't want to, but I can use them to kind of partition and keep track of the data. If I was to look inside Windows, I would only see one file. I wouldn't see these subdivisions in the file. So it's something you only see when you view it within Testlab. I'm going to jump over here to measure. So most of the time when you measure something in Testlab, you can, you know, have a display that shows some data in real time here. I'll just throw that in here and hit arm. I'm gonna acquire data. I would hit this start button. And when I do that, it's going to form something called a run. You see a run up here, I hit start. It's measuring data. I hit stop. And I'll keep that run. I have done one measurement, one recording. It automatically actually incremented the run to this next number, run two. I can hit start. It's taking data again. I'll hit stop. So I've acquired two runs worth of data. And I'll disarm here. And I'm going to go back to the Navigator to view the results. So I was in section modification A. So if I look at modification A, I see my two runs. Under baseline, there's nothing. So hopefully I meant to do modification, although I can tell you I didn't. Up here, you can switch which section is active. When you do the data acquisition, the data will be stored in whatever the active section is. So if I wanted data in baseline condition, I would record here in baseline. Let's do that for fun once. So I'll hit arm and start again. So now I'll have one run of baseline condition, two runs of my modification. One run here, and notice it can have the same name, run one and run one, but they're in two different sections, so I know that they're two different things. And within the run, I have some different parts. One of them is labeled throughput. The word throughput means time data, or sometimes you think of it as raw time data. So you see we have data versus time here. I switched the axes because the real amplitude in Testlab means absolute amplitude. If I do that, you'll see the data never goes below zero. So we wanted real for this time history. So recorded raw time data. And then at the same time, these other settings, online processing, et cetera, it actually processed some data at the same time. So I have some spectrums and things like that. So a typical run, it'll consist of two parts, some folders with processed data, data that was processed online while you were doing the data acquisition, and then a throughput. And the throughput consists of the raw time data, which you can use to reprocess or reanalyze later on. If we look here at the highest level, I got a project. Then it's divided into sections. And then I have runs within those sections. So that's kind of the hierarchy. A few things I wanted to maybe point out about that. You don't have to use sections. So it could have been that when I made my project, I could have said in the project name, Fred Baseline. And I could have had a project called Fred Modified. The sections are really up to you as a user if you want to use them or not. By default, there's a section called Section 1, whether you like it or not. There has to be at least one section. You don't have to use it. Runs, for sure you use. Okay. If I go to measure here, and by the way, if I'm in the middle of measure and I'm like, hey, I don't know what data I have, there's this icon up here, Open Data Explorer. You can actually see the project and what's already been acquired and the contents of it. I'm like, okay, I don't know if I liked run one. I'm going to come in here and I'm going to say run one here. And I'm going to reacquire that data. What happens when I do that? Can I overwrite my data? Yeah, we learned a long time ago, after the release 0.5, overwriting people's data, not a good thing. Nobody seems to like that. So no matter what you do, you can try putting in the same name. It will not overwrite. It'll auto increment. And by the way, this can be a name with any type of characters that you want in it. It doesn't have to be the word run in a run. We will never overwrite your data. People don't like losing their data in general. You, as a user, have to explicitly get rid of it. So if I'm here in my project and I don't like this run, I have to right click and delete. That's the only way to get rid of this data. And when I pick delete, we're going to give you a little, warning message. This is permanently deleted and you can't retrieve it again. Are you sure you want to continue? Anyway, if I say yes, that data is permanently gone. But that's the only way I can permanently delete the data. You can see that I have throughput file, the time history. It looks like it's part of the project, but in reality, it's not. If I go to where I have some project, see if I can find a good one here. Okay, so here I have a project, my test, and I'm gonna give you another trick here. I'm gonna close this project. I still have signature open, and I can drag that project over to here and then it opens it. So I can actually drag projects onto the software that's running to open them from Windows. Anyway, this project .lms contains the sections and the settings and the processed data, but there's a folder you see in Windows, and that folder actually has, if I was to go into the project file itself, it has this throughput file run one, and that is actually contained. Our time files have an extension LDSF. It's contained in the folder next to the project. If I was to copy this project up on my network drive to analyze it, and I forgot to bring this folder, this link to the throughput file won't work. And we do this on purpose because time files can be very, very big. And so they can make the project very big. We want to keep the size pretty small. We also want you actually go into from another project, I can go into that folder and I can actually access and view the time data. And I can do that without interfering with the project that's currently open. So the time files are technically stored in a folder of the same name. They appear to be kind of part of the project, but they're actually separate. Keeps the file sizes smaller and more manageable, allows things to be modular. But you need to be aware of it if you move things around in Windows. If you're copying a project from one directory to another via Windows, don't forget that folder with the same name. Okay. When you're done with the data, you can be in the navigator here. There's some icons for most popular displays, and you can grab data from these icons and drop them. Grab data and drop them in the display. Now, let me just kind of back up. If there were no displays, no drag and drop. So in Testlab here, you have to open the display first, and you got to decide the kind you want to display the data in, and then you can drag and drop. And notice when I drag and drop, see there are yellow folders here? I cannot drag these yellow folders. You need to see this blue icon next to the data. That is something that's draggable and droppable into a display. So if I was to open up something like a waterfall display here and went into waterfalls, notice I keep going till I see that blue icon, and then I can drag the blue icon over into the display. So it's a drag and drop operation. I can have as many displays open at a time as I want. Put them in here. And then if I want to put them in Word or PowerPoint, something like that, I can copy them out as metafiles, bitmaps, that's on this tab here, or as this thing called a active picture. And an active picture is pretty nice. If I right click and hit paste, I have the image, but an active picture is a little bit different. If I double click on it, it activates, and I can use some of the controls like I have in the software, like zooming in, zooming out, and putting on a cursor, reading out the data values, switch this format to DB, for example. And you can do little calculations too. I could add something like a double X cursor, and I can say, hey, I want to know the maximum over this RPM range. So I pick max, and it tells me in the legend here what the maximum is. And I can do a copy values here and jump into Excel and pick paste. And now I have the maximum values in Excel. I didn't have to, this was a static image. I couldn't read those maxes out, or I'd have to get a ruler or something and try and guesstimate what those maxes were. Here I got them very precisely. In the active picture, we kind of have an end-to-end traceability. So that means I can also look at the data properties of this active picture, and I can get an idea of how the data was processed, what project it came from originally, what the cal factor was that was used on the data, what type of window, all that kind of stuff. So I know if this had the right cal factor, wrong cal factor, et cetera.